How do you view all of the aspects of, well, I'll give you this example of climate change. So I did a video several weeks ago about the rising sea levels just in North America are going to make people on the East and West Coast have to move. And the East Coast of the United States has about a third of the country's population. So there's going to be upwards of 100 million climate refugees that are going to have to potentially move inland by the year 2040. So one of the things we were having in the discussion, what are we going to do? Where are all those people going to go? Where are they going to live? Where are they going to work? Where are they going to, all that stuff. So how does MMT factor into that issue and the discussion of that issue?
Well, the issue of climate change creating climate refugees is already, it's already happening. I mean, not yet in the U.S. in the significant kind of dimension that you're describing here, but it's already happening all over Africa, all over the Middle East. I mean, a lot of people forget that the Syrian crisis, the refugee crisis that most people discuss in the media, people think of it as post-Arab Spring, after the civil war, the conflict started. Thousands of people started moving, millions of people started moving. As a matter of fact, 1.5 million climate refugees moved internally within Syria 3 years before the conflict. And this was never reported because Syria experienced the most severe drought in its history. Syria used to be self-sufficient in food production. And with this drought, it completely destroyed people's livelihoods in rural areas. 1.5 million people moved internally. And of course, when they moved to the big cities where they think there's food, there's jobs, there's schools, there's housing. But of course, there wasn't. And that added to the political tension, social and economic tension within the major cities, you know. And of course, the rest of the conflict happened. I'm not saying it was all because of climate change, but it's just one of those things that exacerbates existing tensions and inequalities and things of that nature. It's already happening in so many other countries all over Africa, and in terms of drought, pushing people from rural areas into major cities, and of course, putting so much pressure on government resources and schools and food and all kinds of things. So it's already happening. It's just not reported and not analyzed in a way that highlights the importance of climate change. We highlight the political and democratic and human rights, which are important, but we can't forget the role of climate change in exacerbating all of these problems all over the world. So what you think is going to happen in the US, it's already happening in other parts of the world. So the question is, what is the lens that MMT brings that allows us to address this? In a couple of bullet points, just to remind some of viewers what MMT principles are, so that we're on the same page. And it's one of the frustrating thing about people trying to, you know, comment on MMT without really understanding some of the key features, is they immediately conflate the situation of the U.S., for example, with Zimbabwe or Argentina, and say, well, if we do this, we'll become like Zimbabwe. Well, wait a minute, you know, the U.S. is the U.S. and it has a whole set of institutions, a whole set of financial privileges that Zimbabwe doesn't have. So I can talk about developing countries, I can talk about, you know, countries like the U.S. and Japan, and the issues are separate. But the basic definition that allows us to understand the power of this MMT lens is what we call financial sovereignty or monetary sovereignty. So how do we define it? To start with the basic definition, it's a country that issues its own currency. That's easy. Most countries do that. It's a country that taxes its people in that same currency. So the U.S. will not accept taxes, you know, denominated in Canadian dollars. It has to be U.S. dollars. Mm-hmm. Number three, it's a country that never borrows in a foreign currency. In other words, when the U.S. issues bonds, issues U.S. treasuries, it's always promising to pay you back principal and interest in U.S. dollars and only in U.S. dollars. Now, this is where developing countries start losing financial sovereignty, because they frequently issue debt denominated in dollars and euros and Japanese yen and British pounds. And that's money that they can't issue. That's a currency that they can't control. They have to earn through exports or other means. And that's where they get into a debt trap. So the entire U.S. debt stock is denominated in U.S. dollars. That's full financial sovereignty. And number four, which is related to three, is trying not to peg your currency to gold or silver or a foreign nation's currency. Mm-hmm. So in other words, allowing your exchange rate to fluctuate based on economic conditions and not setting it and locking your interest rate at a particular price. Because if you do that, then you're going to have to, you may get into a situation where you have to borrow in a foreign currency to stabilize your exchange rate. And this is, again, where developing countries get stuck into that situation. And I'll be happy to explain with a very simple example what sets the U.S. apart from a country like Argentina or Syria or Egypt or any developing country that's stuck in a debt trap. So when we talk about government debt in the U.S., it's all in U.S. dollars. But when we talk about developing countries, we have to distinguish between government debt denominated in their national currency, which is sovereign and they can control it, versus what we call the external debt. That's money they borrowed from foreign countries with the promise to pay back in a foreign currency that they don't have, that they can't print, right? And that external debt creates a huge burden on those developing countries. So you would ask the question, why would any country give up its financial sovereignty and start borrowing in a foreign currency? It sounds, you know, silly. Why would you do that if you have the full authority of a sovereign independent government? Well, it turns out it has to do with economic deficiencies that developing countries typically suffer from. And when you zoom in, you find three basic deficiencies that they struggle with. Number one is that they're not self-sufficient in food production. So they end up importing a lot of food just to, you know, keep their society going. Number two, they have an energy deficiency. They have to import a lot of fossil fuels typically to keep their economy running. And now you hear, you know, some of the economists saying, well, they need to produce faster and export more. Well, that means that you have to import more fossil fuels to fuel their economy. Unless, of course, I'm hinting to the solutions here, you invest in renewable energy where you can fuel your economy without having to import. And part of the solution in terms of food is, you know, shifting your food production system to more sustainable local agriculture as opposed to, you know, this export-oriented food growth that many developing countries have pursued for many years. And then the third deficiency, which is a more, you know, structural deficiency, is the fact that these countries that have industrialized over the last few decades, they didn't really industrialize in the same way that Japan industrializes or the US or the UK, because they've been sort of pushed into a situation where they can only specialize in producing low value added content. So for example, if you grab a cell phone or any kind of piece of electronics that's, you know, made in Malaysia or made in any developing country, it's tricky because all the components in there are not made in that country. You know, the high value added content is probably made in, you know, the copyright and the intellectual property stuff is, you know, in the U.S. or in Japan or in, you know, highly industrialized countries. But what you end up doing is buying all the inputs, all the components, shipping them to a developing country and hiring cheap labor to assemble it. So the contribution of that country is low value added content. And that's what they export. They import all the high value added content and they export the low value added content. And in the long run, you're always digging yourself in a bigger hole because you're never catching up. You're always just contributing with the cheap labor, you know, under miserable conditions and no environmental regulations, all that stuff that we talk about. But it's a structural issue. But then they say, well, in order to move up the ladder, you just have to work your way out of it. There's no working your way out of it unless you invest in education, research and development, vocational training to move up the skill set so that you're producing the higher value added content. And that's what the neoliberals typically don't advise you to do, because they tell you also cut spending on education and infrastructure and all the things that will actually solve the problem, right, that tell you not to do it.
Right.
And this is really the trap that developing countries are into. And this is sort of not just an intellectual kind of business discussion here. We're having a discussion about something that touches people's lives on a day-to-day basis. And it's so dangerous politically and socially and so destabilizing because of the following scenario. So if you have a typical developing country that depends on food imports, depends on energy imports, and doesn't have the most sophisticated industries, then at the end of the month or at the end of the year, what they have is they have a trade deficit, which means they import more than what they export. And that means their exchange rate, the value of their currency relative to the dollar, starts to fall, which means the next morning when they're about to go out and buy wheat or rice or medicine or anything for their population, right, because they depend on food imports, those things are going to become more expensive in real terms because their currency is cheaper. And now you have food riots on the streets. And now you have energy riots because people can't afford the bus ride unless the government steps in and borrows in foreign currencies to stabilize the exchange rate and kind of subsidize the existing system and never really fix it, because you're always putting a Band-Aid on this thing.
Oh, right.
And that's really the trap that developing countries suffer from. The U.S. is not in that situation, right? The Japan is not in that situation. The U.K. is not in that situation. So it's frustrating when we're talking specifically about the U.S., somebody throws in Argentina or Japan or Syria or Zimbabwe or whatever, and I say, well, wait a minute, we can have a discussion about that, and I can provide you an MMT-informed solution to those scenarios, but don't tell me that the U.S. is going to go into a hyperinflation cycle like Zimbabwe,
right,
because we're not in the same situation.
Okay, well, that's again, very informative. Well, let me ask you this before we go. What then, to the people watching this, how do people get involved, or how do people participate in this who aren't economists or scientists or whatever? How do they get involved and try to move the needle on this?
Well, for the average person who's not involved in politics, is not involved in academia, the best group that can think of is Real Progressives, which is a grassroots organization. You can find them on Facebook, on Twitter. It's sort of turning into a media company, a small media company, lots of interviews with MMT activists and MMT economists and legal scholars and others, environmentalists and people running for office with an MMT-informed public policy platform. Mm-hmm. You'll hear all those voices on Real Progressives. You'll get plugged into tons of resources. In terms of public policy think tanks, there's the Global Institute. Check us out on social media, on the website. There's the Levy Economics Institute at Bard College. Also, lots of my colleagues there do fantastic work. And the truth is that we're outnumbered.